And now we welcome Perla.
In Lakesh, Alakin, you are another me, I am another you. This is a phrase my husband and I have told each other since we were dating because we felt deeply connected, and we even got it engraved in our wedding rings. And after we got married, we really looked forward to having kids. We loved talking about how we were going to raise them. Growing up, I had a really challenging relationship with my mom. I never felt good enough for her. I always felt like a burden. We were just so disconnected. And my husband and I said we didn't want that for our kids, and we promised we were going to do it differently. And so 4 years into our marriage, we had our daughter. And 2.5 years after that, we had our son. And life with two kids is pretty hard, you know, it's challenging, but we were doing pretty good, and, you know, we were practicing gentle parenting and all that. But then shortly after our son turned a year old, I found out I was pregnant, and I was having twins. And as soon as those little Capricorn goats were born, our world was turned upside down. We moved in with my in-laws for support, and I committed to staying home full time because childcare is ridiculously expensive, so you can only imagine for four. And it was hard. I was definitely suffering from postpartum anxiety and depression. I was very sleep deprived. And a year and a half into it, I was burnt out. There were times when everything just went off at the same time. I had my 3-year-old yelling at me from the bathroom, asking me to wipe his butt. My 6-year-old is sneaking out of her virtual classroom. I have one of my twins drawing a mural on the wall with a permanent marker, and I can't do anything about any of it because I am in the middle of the worst of the worst diaper changes with the other twin. And at the same time, I had a cockatoo in the background screaming, "Bampa, Bampa," which is what my kids call my father-in-law. It mimicked everything. And I have our 3 dogs nonstop barking at the door because I can't get to it, obviously, all while dealing with the anxiety of needing to keep the noise level down because my mother-in-law worked from home and was taking phone calls. And not to mention, every morning I was dealing with my husband's 94-year-old grandmother from Watts, who called me a bruja because the coffee was nasty and she swears I'm trying to poison her. And I didn't even make the coffee, but I always got blamed for it. And it was chaos. Every single day was just this nonstop loop. And it was like los trastes y la ropa, toys everywhere, dealing with multiple tantrums at the same time, no inspiration to cook. I was exhausted. And the only time I felt relief was when my kids would nap or when they were in bed at night. And so one day, my three little ones are watching TV, and so I'm like, okay, everything's good, and I go to my room to go get something. It's not even a minute. I come out, and I look down the hallway, and I see one of the twins on the kitchen counter. And before I can even get to her, she sees me, and she's like, "Look, Mommy!" And she has this 16-ounce glass measuring cup over her head, and she smashes it onto the marble counter, and glass shatters everywhere. I was in shock. And then I was so embarrassed because my mother-in-law worked from home, and she came out to see what happened. And immediately, I have the voices in my head, "Ay, Perla, qué tonta, ¿cómo dejaste que pasara esto?" And every day I felt like a huge glass cup was being smashed in my house and I couldn't pick up the pieces. I was so stressed out. And this stress was physically manifesting in me. I had this like piercing headache all the time, heart palpitations, this constant feeling of just wanting to rip my skin off. I was completely dysregulated and depleted. And so I lost my shit. Multiple times, I became a rageful parent. And I felt so horrible because my kids were so little. I felt like a monster. I became what I said I would never become. And you know, it wasn't like this all the time. My kids did bring me joy. We had bonding moments, but I just was always triggered. And I was always responding with this defensiveness. And then my husband was also burnt out. He was working a social work job, dealing with clients who are trying to take their lives every day. We were just on survival mode. And I just became so angry with myself and so ashamed because I knew this wasn't right. But I was just in this constant battle with myself. And so when I wasn't angry, I was crying, either because of the chaos or because my kids would give me hugs and kisses, and I just felt so undeserving. And one day, I just cried my heart out. And I said, I can't do this anymore. I just can't. And so I took a deep breath because I really lost myself. And I prioritized myself. I took care of my mental health. I went to see a therapist, a doctor, a naturopath. I started meditating and journaling consistently. I took parenting classes. And things thankfully got better. I was less on edge. I was, I wasn't yelling at my kids as much. And then some weeks into this transition, I go to my parents' house. And I don't know what the conversation was, but I just remember my mom responding to me. ¿Y por qué no lo hiciste así? Yo así lo hubiera hecho así. Es que no piensas. And I was livid. You think I haven't tried that yet? Like, what the hell? And I just stormed off with the kids. I'm yelling at them, get in the car, hurry up. And I'm trying to sit them down, buckle them up. And I'm just so frustrated because here I am trying to be better. And I'm just reverting back to my rage and feeling so activated by my mom. And as I pull out of the driveway, she comes over to my driver's side. I see her running out, and she lowers her shoulders. And for the first time ever, she tells me, Perla, perdóname. In Spanish, she tells me, it's just, I get so sad seeing you struggle so much, and I just want to help. Sigue tomando tu medicina, sigue yendo a la terapia. No quiero perderte. Te quiero mucho y quiero que estés bien. And I just said, gracias, mamá. Yo también la quiero mucho. And I drove off in tears because all I wanted was to be seen and held without critique. And especially by my own mother during such a vulnerable and difficult time in my life. And this whole time, I thought my rage was what was wrong with me. I thought that's what I was saying no to, but my rage was a sign. It was telling me, hey, like something's wrong. It was like a check engine light. It was like my inner child begging me to call my spirit back, to remember what it felt like to be a kid. And so when I did that, I was then able to finally say no to the oppressive, colonized programming embedded in me, telling me that my kids can't be loud, that they can't have big feelings, that they can't cry, and that they can't make mistakes. And it was affirmation for me that it's okay to cry, that I don't need to be perfect, that I can have big feelings and make mistakes. But I really needed to regulate myself in order to do that. And when I did that, I was able to re-embrace in La Quiche and see my children in me and me in my children. Even in the most difficult moments, we now breathe through big feelings. We give hugs to regulate. We really try to prioritize quality time and fun to get out of the monotony of the day-to-day stress because los trastes y la ropa is always gonna be there. And I really strive to lean in with curiosity before attacking my kids for their behavior. And by doing that, to be very honest, I still have my moments, I still have that rage creeping in, but I remember it's a sign, and I use it as a moment to reassess, and I use it as a moment to really, redirect myself and prioritize my self-care, not just so I can be a better parent for my kids, but so that I could be better for me, and so that I can help heal the generations that come before me and after me. Thank you.